Hey guys, today I wanted to talk about a pretty serious issue, and this was brought about by some recent events that happened in Texas in some PCA churches. There's a group called Concerned Presbyterians that went around putting some pamphlets on people's cars after the church services to fight against some of the statements regarding racial reconciliation that the PCA made at its last General Assembly. And this brings across the question of racism in the church and what is a proper response to racism in the church, and how do we approach these issues? Now, you know, growing up, I never really encountered racism. I grew up in Massachusetts, and, one of my best friends growing up was black. And to be honest, like, I barely ever encountered it in my own experience. And it took me a long time before I actually began encountering racism and really understood some of the issues that go on in our culture today, and coming to a realization that this isn't just stuff of the past. These are major issues that that we have to confront today and that the church has to confront today. The first instance I can remember of confronting racism and really experiencing it was that black friend of mine, his mother visited, they were Christians, and his mother was visiting some other churches because they had been going to, you know, a predominantly black congregation in Springfield, Massachusetts, which was about a half hour away. And they wanted to check out the Baptist church in town. So they went to the fundamentalist Baptist King James only church in town. And after the service, this woman went to shake some people's hands, and she went to shake the pastor's hand and say thank you for the message this morning. And they would not shake her hand because, well, they were racists. And so the first time I ever experienced racism was actually in the context of church, a fundamentalist Baptist church, which was something very different than what I experienced before. And I remember talking to my friend about this and coming to a realization, like, you know, people still believe this stuff. I was a teenager, I think, at the time, before I'd ever really seen this. And people in the church are still holding on to racist positions. I remember sometime later confronting another Christian, supposedly, who found out I was a Christian in my hometown. And when he found out I was a Christian, he started going on a rant about how, he started using the N-word and all this stuff about racism, and, you know, about how terrible black people were. And I was just shocked. And this guy assumed, because I was a Christian, apparently that meant I was a racist. And in the churches I had been a part of, I was a part of a couple different churches growing up, those were never issues at all. We had black people in the congregation, and we had people of other races in the congregation, and nobody really cared. We thought, you know, whatever, they're just people like we are. But that really opened my eyes, a couple of the experiences that I had had, to the fact that there are such big race issues still in the church, and we need to confront those and figure out how to deal with those as a church even today. Now, I know things have gotten worse nowadays. The tensions seem to have built up for a bunch of reasons culturally. And so the racism is not dead in the church, and we have to confront it. And so this recent event brings up a whole subject that is something called kinism. And kinism is something that exists particularly within confessional Presbyterian churches, and it's really small. It's not as big as they would like to make themselves seem. You know, they want to put their voices out there as if there's this giant horde of these racist people in the church. And of course, they'll all claim not to be racist, because who claims they're racist, right? Every single person that's racist says they're not racist. Nobody says, I'm racist. And, you know, if you ask somebody who's racist, the racists say, no, I don't hate black people. That means they're not racist. So you can, you know, never want to talk to a black person, think that interracial marriage is bad, think that their culture is completely horrible and inferior, and never want to be around those people. But as long as you say you don't hate them, you're not racist. That seems to be the way that racists operate. So people in the KKK say, oh, they're not racist because they don't hate black people. Now, get them around their KKK friends and listen to what they have to say, and you'll find out, hey, they actually very much do hate black people. But of course, the public face is just, well, no, we're just preserving European white culture. That's it. Which is never really, really the case. So kinism basically is this movement that says that God has made racial boundaries as part of creation, and we must keep those racial boundaries even in the church today. And so there are different cultures, you know, there's the white European culture, of course, then there's black culture, and they need to separate into their own churches. We need to have our own churches, and those Jews, you know, if there's Jewish Christians, you keep your own culture. We don't want anything to do with any of those groups. You just do your own thing. You can't get married to people of other races, and supposedly this is something that God has ordained. And if you look at the scriptural arguments, I mean, they're really bad. And I think that when you look at these movements, you find that it's really an issue of it is bigotry. And I know people throw around that word to, you know, just as kind of a way to dismiss somebody's argument, to just say you're a bigot. And so I don't want to do that. But at the same time, it really is. The people that I've seen using these arguments from supposedly scripture, when I've seen them have conversations with each other, they're really just insulting people of other races. That's what they do. And that's at least been my experience. And in fact, I've never met a Kinist who didn't actually just insult people of other races and was just strictly saying that biblically they believed that this was the case. So I think that there's an underlying racism that really is the cause of this. And if you look at some of the scripture they use, it's just really bad, the arguments. You know, they'll say, well, God made everything according to its own kind. Well, okay, God did make everything according to its kind. But if you look at Genesis, that means, you know, like animals are their own kind, humans are their own kind. There's no obviously there's no reason to think that this means that different races are of their own kind. And then they'll go to things like the Tower of Babel, the fact that God separates people into tribes, tongues, and nations by separating languages. But realize that's sin. You know, sin causes division in race. Sin is the thing that caused cultural divisions and made people separate from one another. And in the New Testament, at the time of Pentecost, we actually see that sin being reversed. The gospel unites people where they were previously divided, right? Sin is the thing that divided us. At Babel, God said, all right, I've got to make all these different cultures and races because of the, you know, the awful sin that's getting involved here. And then at Pentecost, God makes the apostles then speak in languages that everyone can understand. And now where there was division, there is unity. And that's the theme in the whole New Testament, is all of the divisions that we had previously now are overcome. Now people are coming to the unity that is in Christ. We are all part of the same church. We are part of one Christ, one faith, one Lord, one baptism. The New Testament uses this language all over the place. And everywhere we see any racial divisions in the New Testament, it's always frowned upon. You know, I mean, look at the book of Galatians. You have Jews wanting to sit at their table and the Gentiles are over here and we don't want to intermix with them. And Paul so clearly condemns it and he calls it another gospel. And the issues there aren't just ones of following the Jewish ceremonial law, but also of division. That's why he is constantly talking about being one in Christ. You know, there's no Jew, Greek, male, female, slave, free. Paul makes those points there, and he's talking in terms of table fellowship there. So it doesn't mean that there's no difference between male and female and things like that. But what he's talking about is their place in the church and their fellowship in the church. So Paul didn't say, well, here's the Jewish church, now here's the Gentile church, and you guys stick to your own people and stick to your own. Or maybe Jews and Gentiles, maybe you can come to the same church, but just make sure you don't intermarry. He doesn't do any of that. I mean, the whole point of the New Testament in the way that it addresses race issues, it never points to division. It's always the opposite. It's always from division to unity. That's just the whole pattern coming from the Old into the New Testament. So one of the things that people will bring up who defend racism in the Old Testament is that God told the Jews not to intermarry with other races. And they'll say, well, look, God said Jews are Jews, Gentiles are Gentiles. We don't want intermix. Well, what was really going on there? And I think it's pretty clear when we actually look at the patterns of the Old Testament is that God is trying to stop individuals from marrying those who are of another faith. And the problems and the warnings are always about people having another faith and worshiping false gods and bringing that worship of false gods into Judaism. And that's what happens in the Old Testament. That's what's condemned, is when people are marrying those of other faiths and other religions, they're bringing their false pagan practices now into the Jewish faith. And so God is trying to make the faith pure of Israel so that Jesus Christ can be born from the people of Israel and redeem the world. That's the whole purpose. And even when you look at the genealogy of Jesus, it's not a perfect Jewish genealogy. Rahab is mentioned there. Was that a sin? Was that wrong for Rahab? No, God was always bringing the Gentiles in too. And so there was no perfect, pure line of one race even there. And so it's very clear, you know, that the whole point of this division was to purify the religion of the people of Israel. There's no precedent for saying this is some kind of mandate that continues into the new covenant that we need to marry people of our own race. That's never mentioned in the New Testament. There's nothing like that. There's no indication of that whatsoever. And when Paul applies those principles, when he talks about marriage, the only division he makes is between believer and unbeliever. That's it. And, you know, he's writing to the Corinthians about this. And Corinth has Jews, and it has Gentiles. Now, he's writing instructions about marriage. Now, he doesn't say, hey, make sure the Jews only marry Jews. Make sure the Gentiles only marry Gentiles. You know, make sure you stay within your people group. Now, he doesn't do that. Because that's not the point. Now we're identified not by our race, but we're identified by our faith in Jesus Christ. That's the thing that unites us. It's not about race. These things don't matter at all. It's not about your skin color or any of that stuff. So I think that's a huge problem interpreting it that way. And, you know, they'll point to racists have always done this. And they'll point to, you know, the mark of Cain. And then there was a curse upon Ham, and that means Ham was black. Well, there's no indication that Ham was black. And if you look at the curse upon Ham, there's a very specific fulfillment of that curse upon Ham, which is that he was going to be the father of the Canaanites, who were the people that the Israelites were going to have to wipe out because their culture would get so messed up and corrupted. We have the fulfillment of that in the Old Testament. It doesn't say, oh, and they got dark skin, and then those are the people that went to Africa, and everyone with dark skin is cursed. Not even close. There's no indication of that. And all that is just a bunch of racist ideology just shoved into the scriptural text. And so you just can't find these racial divisions in the Bible. You can't find it. The only racial divisions you find in the Bible are, yes, God separated a particular people through Abraham to bring forth the seed that was Jesus Christ. And once Christ has come, now we are united not by ethnicity, but by faith. We're even told, you know, being a son of Abraham, Paul uses this in Galatians, that really being, and Romans, that being a son of Abraham is really about having the faith of Abraham. It was never really about ethnicity in the first place. Ethnicity really wasn't the thing that really mattered. It was there to bring forth Jesus so that the world could be saved, but that's the emphasis, so that the world could be saved. We're brought into the same family by faith in Jesus Christ. And so, you know, we've got to confront racism in the church today. And maybe, you know, you're like me when I was growing up and you just didn't see it. And you didn't realize that it was such an issue. And let me just tell you, it is. You know, it is. Even if maybe your area of the country, the place where you live, you haven't confronted it yet. But there are probably racists in that area too. And let me tell you, all across this nation, and I'm sure it's not different across the world, there are racial issues that exist in the church. So we have to be willing to confront those issues, and we have to confront them biblically, and we have to say that racism is a sin, and to denigrate anybody based on the color of their skin or on their culture being supposedly inferior to yours, it's a sin, and you need to repent. And there is forgiveness in Christ, but you need to repent. And that is not a biblical way of thinking. We are identified by our faith in Jesus Christ. Doesn't matter what culture you're from, doesn't matter what color your skin is, it is faith in Jesus Christ that unites us in His kingdom. Thanks so much for watching. If you want to see other videos, check out what else is on my channel, like and subscribe. And if you have other video topics, things you want me to address in the church or dealing with different aspects of Christian theology, just let me know, and we'll see you next time. God bless.